Good morning. Thank you for joining me for Sunday Morning Cafe in a Chapter. This morning, we're going to read the first part of the first chapter of Dreams from My Father, written by Barack Obama. Chapter 1. A few months after my 21st birthday, a stranger called to give me the news. I was living in New York at the time, on 94th between 2nd and 1st, part of that unnamed shifting border between East Harlem and the rest of Manhattan. It was an uninviting block, treeless and barren, lined with soot-colored walk-ups that cast heavy shadows for most of the day. The apartment was small, with slanting floors and irregular heat and a buzzer downstairs that didn't work, so that visitors had to call ahead from a payphone at the corner gas station, where a black Doberman the size of a wolf paced through the night in vigilant patrol, its jaws clamped around an empty beer bottle. None of this concerned me much, for I didn't get many visitors. I was impatient in those days, busy with work and unrealized plans, and prone to see other people as unnecessary distractions. It wasn't that I didn't appreciate company exactly. I enjoyed exchanging Spanish pleasantries with my mostly Puerto Rican neighbors. And on my way back from classes, I usually stopped to talk to the boys who hung out on the stoop all summer long about the Knicks or the gunshots they'd heard the night before. When the weather was good, my roommate and I might sit out on the fire escape to smoke cigarettes and study the dusk washing blue over the city, or watch white people from the better neighborhoods nearby walk their dogs down our block to let their animals shit on our curbs. "Scoop the poop, you bastards," my roommate would shout with impressive rage. And we'd laugh at the faces of both master and beast, grim and unapologetic as they hunkered down to do the deed. I enjoyed such moments, but only in brief. If the talk began to wander or cross the border into familiarity, I would soon find reason to excuse myself. I had grown too comfortable in my solitude, the safest place I knew. I remember there was an old man living next door who seemed to share my disposition. He lived alone, a gaunt, stooped figure who wore a heavy black overcoat and a misshapen fedora on those rare occasions when he left his apartment. Once in a while, I'd run into him on the way back from his way back from the store, and I would offer to carry his groceries up the long flight of stairs. He would look at me and shrug, and we would begin our ascent, stopping at each landing so that he could catch his breath. When we finally arrived at his apartment, I'd carefully set the bags down on the floor, and he would offer a courtly nod of acknowledgement before shuffling inside and closing the latch. Not a single word would pass between us, and not once did he ever thank me for my efforts. The old man's silence impressed me. I thought him a kindred spirit. Later, my roommate would find him crumpled up on the third floor landing, his eyes wide open, his limbs stiff and curled up like a baby's. A crowd gathered. A few of the women crossed themselves, and the smaller children whispered with excitement. Eventually, the paramedics arrived to take the body away, and the police let themselves into the old man's apartment. It was neat, almost empty. A chair, a desk, the faded portrait of a woman with heavy eyebrows and a gentle smile set atop the mantelpiece. Somebody opened the refrigerator and found close to $1,000 in small bills rolled up inside wads of old newspaper and carefully arranged behind mayonnaise and pickle jars. The loneliness of the scene affected me, and for the briefest moment, I wished that I had learned the old man's name. Then, almost immediately, I regretted my desire, along with its companion grief. I felt as if an understanding had been broken between us, as if, in that barren room, the old man was whispering an untold history, telling me things I preferred not to hear. It must have been a month or so later, on a cold, dreary November morning, the sun faint behind a gauze of clouds, that the other call came. I was in the middle of making myself breakfast, with coffee on the stove and 2 eggs in the skillet, when my roommate handed me the phone. The line was thick with static. "Barry? Barry, is this you?" "Yes, who's this?" "Yes, Barry, this is your Aunt Jane in Nairobi. Can you hear me?" "I'm sorry, who did you say you were?" "Aunt Jane, listen, Barry, your father is dead. He is killed in a car accident. Hello, can you hear me? I say, your father is dead. Barry, please call your uncle in Boston and tell him. I can't talk now, okay, Barry? I will try to call you again." That was all. The line cut off and I sat down on the couch, smelling eggs burning in the kitchen, staring at cracks in the plaster, trying to measure my loss. At the time of his death, my father remained a myth to me, both more and less than a man. He had left Hawaii back in 1963, when I was only 2 years old, so that as a child, I knew him only through the stories that my mother and grandparents told. They all had their favorites, each one seamless, burnished smooth from repeated use. I can still picture Gramps leaning back in his old stuffed chair after dinner, sipping whiskey and cleaning his teeth with a cellophane from his cigarette pack, recounting the time that my father almost threw a man off the Pali lookout because of a pipe. See, your mom and dad decided to take this friend of his sightseeing around the island. So they drove up to the lookout, and Barack was probably on the wrong side of the road the whole way over there. Your father was a terrible driver, my mother explains to me. He'd end up on the left-hand side, the way the British drive, and if you said something, he'd just huff about silly American rules. Well, this particular time, they arrived in one piece, and they got out and stood at the railing to admire the view. And Barack, he was puffing away on this pipe that I'd given him for his birthday, pointing out all the sights with esteem, like a sea captain. Your father was really proud of this pipe, my mother interrupts again. He'd smoke it all night while he studied, and sometimes, look, Anne, do you want to tell the story, or are you going to let me finish? Sorry, Dad, go ahead. Anyway, this poor fella, he was another African student, wasn't he? Fresh off the boat. This poor kid must have been impressed with the way Barack was holding forth with his pipe, because he asked if he could give it a try. Your dad thought about it for a minute and finally agreed. And as soon as the fella took his first puff, he started coughing up a fit, coughed so hard that the pipe slid out of his hand and dropped over the railing 100 feet down the face of the cliff. Gramps stops to take another nip from his flask before continuing. Well now, your dad was gracious enough to wait until his friend stopped coughing before he told him to climb over the railing and bring the pipe back. The man took one peek down this 90-degree incline and told Barack that he'd buy him a replacement. Quite sensibly, Toot says from the kitchen. We call my grandmother Tutu, Toot for short. It means grandparent in Hawaiian, for she decided on the day I was born that she was still too young to be called Granny. Gramps scowls, but decides to ignore her. But Barack was adamant about getting his pipe back because it was a gift and couldn't be replaced. So the fella took another look and shook his head, and that's when your dad picked him clear off the ground and started dangling him over the railing. Gramps lets out a hoot and gives his knee a jovial slap. As he laughs, I imagine myself looking up at my father, dark against the brilliant sun, the transgressor's arms flailing about as he's held aloft, a fearsome vision of justice. He wasn't really holding him over the railing, Dad, my mother says, looking to me with concern. But Gramps takes another sip of whiskey and plows forward. At this point, other people were starting to stare, and your mother was begging Barack to stop. I guess Barack's friend was just holding his breath and saying his prayers. Anyway, after a couple of minutes, your dad set the man back down on his feet, patted him on the back, and suggested, calm as you please, that they all go find themselves a beer. And don't you know, that's how your dad acted for the rest of the tour, like nothing happened. Of course, your mother was still pretty upset when they got home. In fact, she was barely talking to your dad. Barack wasn't helping matters any either, because when your mom tried to tell us what happened, he just shook his head and started to laugh. Relax, Anna, he said to her. Your dad had this deep baritone C and this British accent. My grandfather tucks his chin into his neck at this point to capture the full effect. Relax, Anna, he said. I only wanted to teach the chap a lesson about the proper care of other people's property. Gramps would start to laugh again until he started to cough, and Toot would mutter under her breath that she supposed it was a good thing that my father had realized that dropping the pipe had just been an accident, because who knows what might have happened otherwise, and my mother would roll her eyes at me and say they were exaggerating. Your father can be a bit domineering, my mother would admit with a hint of a smile. But it's just that he is basically a very honest person that makes him uncompromising sometimes. She preferred a gentler portrait of my father. She would tell the story of when he arrived to accept his Pi Beta Kappa key in his favorite outfit, jeans and an old knit shirt with a leopard print pattern. Nobody told him it was this big honor, so he walked in and found everyone standing around this elegant room dressed in tuxedos. The only time I ever saw him embarrassed. And Gramps, suddenly thoughtful, would start nodding to himself. It's a fact, Bear, he would say. Your dad could handle just about any situation, and that made everybody like him. Remember the time he had to sing at the International Music Festival? He'd agreed to sing some African songs, but when he arrived, it turned out to be this big to-do, and the woman who performed just before him was a semi-professional singer, a Hawaiian gal with a full band to back her up. Anyone else would have stopped right there, you know, and explained that there had been a mistake, but not Barack. He got up and started singing in front of this big crowd, which is no easy feat, let me tell you. And he wasn't great, but he was so sure of himself that before you knew it, he was getting as much applause as anybody. My grandfather would shake his head and get out of his chair to flip on the TV set. Now there's something you can learn from your dad, he would tell me. Confidence, the secret to a man's success. And that ends the first part of chapter one of Dreams from My Father. If you are interested in borrowing this book, it is available to borrow as a print book, a book on CD, an ebook, or an e-audiobook. Barack Obama is also the author of The Audacity of Hope. If you need any assistance requesting materials or have any questions, please call the North for Sales Library at 412-823-2222 or email us at nversales@einetwork.net. Thanks for joining me.